So my dear friends, when we have readings which has got words like do not be afraid, courage, God will take care of you, we do feel comforted. We do feel nice when somebody tells us, don't worry, God will help us. But the problem is today, in spite of being mentioning God's word all the time, there is very little moments where we really appreciate it as moments of truth, moments when we encounter God. And because of that, we find that very often we are always caught in our own little problem. We remain inside the boat of our own problems. A story is told of a man who was doing business with his partners, and the partners cheated him and he was very heartbroken. So the wife and the children tried to encourage him to move ahead, but he just couldn't. He felt so betrayed, so hurt by what the friends did to him. So one day the wife told him, come, I have made a vow. We will go to this island for a pilgrimage. Maybe after that you will feel better. So as they were going on the boat, first it was a smooth ride. Then after some time, there was a big commotion. There was a loud sound and then there was a big commotion and everybody began to panic. And then the captain of the boat spoke to them. We went and hit against something under the sea just now. And our boat has got a small hole in it. Water is coming into the boat. We have to reduce the weight of the boat by half. Please throw away everything in the boat. So they started to throw all the table, the chairs, whatever they feel that they really don't need, they started to throw. After that, the captain said, thank you for throwing things. Now we are slightly lighter. I will try to reach the nearest island. At least we'll be safe there. But it is still not enough. You have to throw away your own personal belongings. Just keep the ones which are truly necessary. The rest, please throw. So the people were a bit upset. How to throw all the important things they brought? But then finally, one by one, they started to throw out the things that they didn't need. And the boat was getting even lighter. And finally, due to the smart move of the captain, he was able to reach the island and the whole passengers, all of them were saved. And as they got down from the boat, the wife of this man looked up at him and said, you see, dear, just now when the boat was having a hole, the ship was sinking, the only thing the captain thought of was about us, how to save us. He told us to unload all the things in the boat first. Then he even asked us to throw away our own things so that he can save us. Myself and my children have been in your boat for many months now. Your boat is sinking. Why are you not throwing away your hurts and pains? Why are you pulling us down with you? Let it go. Lighten yourself. Then we can move ahead as a family. That was the moment of encounter for the husband. He realized the need sometimes for us to let go of our past experience, learn the lessons from it, but most importantly is appreciate the present, the family, the wife and the children who are with him. Don't sink everybody because of the mistake somebody else has made. And that is the encountering God will do to us. When we truly encounter God, our direction in life changes. In the first reading today, we see Prophet Elijah is very upset. If you want to know the story, we have to read one chapter earlier, 1 Kings chapter 18. Elijah has already had a battle with all the Baal prophets, and then he will kill 450 of the Baal prophets, he will destroy the idols, and then he will move. He will come away from that place. When Jezebel, the king's wife, knows about it, she will tell, by tomorrow this time I'm going to kill you. And Elijah was very upset, very angry, so he will run. He will run and then God will provide him some food. Ravens will bring some food and then finally he will walk again and he will reach Mount Horeb. And he's in the Mount Horeb, he's waiting there. He's waiting for God to come. And says, wait, I will come and meet you there. And he's there and then the first thing he sees is the wind, very strong wind. But he says, God was not in the wind. Then comes the earthquake. but God was not in the earthquake. After that came a fire. God was not in the fire. After that came a silent breeze. He covered his face and went to the entrance of the cave. The next line is the most important line, which is not in the reading today. God will ask him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" That is the question God will ask him. What are you doing here? And then he will tell, "I am full of zeal for the people and for God. But everybody has left the faith. They are no longer following the covenant of Yahweh. I am the only one left and they want to kill me also." And what did God tell him? He said, "No, don't worry." God didn't tell him, "You go somewhere else." He said, "No, go back. Appoint Hazael as the king of Aram, Jehu as the king of Israel, and Elisha as your successor." He sends him back to the same situation he was in, but with an enlightened mind. He knew that God was sending him back to the place he was running away from. And that is what sometimes encountering God will do to us, my dear friends. Very often, sometimes we cry, we try to complain. We have been praying for our children, our husband, our wife, for conversion for so long. After 20 years of praying, nothing has happened. Correct. Nothing has happened to you. Nothing has happened to the other person who has been praying. Why didn't anything happen? If we have been truly praying for 20 years, even if the other person didn't encounter God, we would have encountered God. Why didn't we encounter God? Is it because of selfish reasons? Do we really do things, even sometimes in ministries in the church, we can fall into this trap of doing it just for fame, glory, power. We want to be recognized. Same thing going on in the political world. The same mindset also enters the church, so much so that we forget that place of encountering God must take primary precedence over all our activities in the church. When they come to the church, when they come for prayer, people must encounter God. And if we are obstacle to that, woe to us. Jesus will tell it very simply. If anyone should cause one of these little ones to sin, better for him to tie a millstone around his neck and thrown into the sea. That's how Jesus is when we stop or prevent somebody from encountering God. But sometimes, what is the real problem? Why is it that we are finding it difficult to encounter God? In the second reading today, Paul is being very sad. He says, Israel is a very chosen race. God chose them. He blessed them. He gave them law. He gave them rituals. He gave them the patriarchs. He gave them the covenant. He even gave Jesus through their line, through their race, through their nation. Even Jesus the Messiah came. And yet they were not able to see or even to encounter this Jesus as the Messiah. What happened? I'm sure some of you would have seen the movies, a series, Pirates of the Caribbean. Jack Sparrow, the leading cast. And the most important element in that movie is the compass. The compass that Jack Sparrow holds in his hand never points to the north. It only points to the desire of the heart. What he wants to achieve, and that is where the compass will show. And most of us today are having a same compass like Jack Sparrow. We do not have a compass which is pointing towards north, towards God. We have a compass which is always following our own heart's desire, and therefore we are always not happy. No matter how hard we try, we feel empty. No matter what we do, we find nothing is useful or meaningful in life. And today Paul is reminding us, remember, you are a chosen race. God has chosen you. And because of this election, we must encounter God. During our daily lives, we meet many people, many things happen to us. Nothing happens by accident or coincidence. Everything has been dictated by God. He wants to tell us something. He wants to use us as his instrument every day. And only when we cooperate with him, then we will find meaning. We will find that something today has gone right for me. I made a difference in somebody's life. And that is what encountering God is all about. It is about we meeting God in others and allowing others to meet God in us. And in the gospel today we find Jesus, after the feeding of the multiplication of the loaves, which we had last week, in Mark, in Matthew, in John, all these three gospels, after the multiplication of the loaf, immediately comes this episode where Jesus is walking on the sea. All these three, there are three gospels. Three gospels, immediately after the multiplication of the loaves, you have the story of the Jesus walking on the sea. So the story begins with Jesus sending the disciples away on the boat. Sea of Galilee, the widest range is about 7 miles. So it's more than about 10 kilometers from one coast to the other. It is not a small sea. It is a very, quite a large sea. It holds substantial amount of water. A lot of greeneries, a lot of fish in that sea. But today Jesus is going by himself to pray. But where else? They are going to the place where it is fertile, where it is full of fish, very lively place. But what happens? Jesus is praying and encountering God. Where else? They are struggling, battling with a headwind. Two different kind of a scenario. Two things are happening here. But Jesus knows that they are in crisis. That is why he is walking on the water towards them. And this one, I think many of us will follow. We will understand this very clearly. When we are praying, when we are doing something, something in our heart tells us, hey, something is going wrong. Go and check your father. Something is burning in the kitchen. Go and see what is in the kitchen. Or something you feel like you want to visit somebody or call somebody and you'll find something is actually happening there. And that is when God is trying to tell us something. Go and talk to this person or contact that person. Today, Jesus had the same inclination. He was praying and he was told, go. The disciples are already battling in the sea. The same thing will happen also when Moses receives the Ten Commandments. God will tell him, go down. The people you brought have been quick to apostatize. God will tell him, go down. The people have already left the religion. So fast they have already forgotten me. Today Jesus goes to them walking on the sea. And the first reaction of the disciples was, it is a ghost. Even disciples staying with Jesus, living with Jesus, walking with Jesus can still believe in ghosts. Catholics also come to church, pray, receive all the sacrament. When we see somebody, we will still say, it is a ghost. We cannot see God, we can only see ghosts. Why? Because fear is very powerful. Whenever we are fearful, we don't say it is God. Very often we will say it is the ghost. And today the disciples fall into the same situation. But Jesus has these consoling words, courage. It is I, be not afraid. The it is I used here is the same word, I am. So this is one of the incidents in the Gospels where Jesus is actually saying that he is divine. When Moses was sent by God to Egypt also, Moses will ask God the same question. If I go to the people and they ask me what is his name, what am I to tell? Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, 15. And then God will tell him, I am who I am. Tell the people, I am has sent you to them. And today Jesus is also taking the same word here. It is I. Courage. God is here. Be not afraid. And Peter wants to go one step ahead. He'll say, Lord, if it is you, command me to come on the water. I also want to overtake this. I also want to do this thing. And Peter got out of the boat and started walking towards Jesus. As long as Peter was looking at Jesus, he was going in the right direction. The moment he started to look at the wind and the waves, he started to sink. And this is very true in our whole life. Whoever we are, in whatever situation we are in, we have a choice. We can either look at Christ or we can look at others. When we look at others, when we compare ourselves with others, we will tend to sink. So my dear friend, there are two dimensions to our faith. One is a valid faith and the other one is a fruitful faith. Many, many people have valid faith. We believe in Jesus. We believe in the sacraments. Whatever God tells, we believe. We read the Bible, we believe. We believe everything. But what is the problem? we finding it difficult to leave this conviction. Just believing in whatever God tells and the Bible tells and the church tells us that we have a valid faith. Our faith is valid. We do not follow other gods. But the problem is, it is not a fruitful faith. Our faith must be fruitful. We must bring others to Christ. We must see changes in our own lives. We must always make sure that whatever we do, God takes precedence and we are not shy about it. When we are able to manifest our beliefs and faith even in the midst of others, then our faith is bearing fruit. If not, we have faith, but that faith is only a valid faith, not a fruitful faith. So, my dear friends, today as we come to celebrate this Eucharist, we give to God all our doubts, all our uncertainties, all our pains. Yes, it is true. Some of us have been suffering for many years without a solution in sight. But then God knows us. When God wants to encounter us, He can use any means. For Moses, God used the burning bush. For St. Paul, it was the lightning. God can use either good things or bad things to get our attention. But the most important thing is when we realize, yes, it is God who is talking to me. It is God who is telling me these things. So as we celebrate this day, my dear friends, we also pray that we will learn like Elijah to encounter God in the silence. For Psalm 46:10 also will tell us. Psalm 46:10 will always remind us to be still and know that I am God.